Warning, do not listen to this podcast if hearing about freedom and liberty is not legal for you in your community. And if so, you should immediately move to a hipper community.
Welcome to the Freedom FEENS Podcast, a weekly web lab where Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi cover the punk rockinist, hip-hopinist current events, as well as timeless universal truths about life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, because there's no such thing as half free. The Freedom FEENS Podcast, available from freedomfeens.com. That's FreedomFeens.com.
Freedom Fiends is proudly syndicated by Alterati.com, the Liberty Radio Network, and No Agenda Global Radio.
Welcome to the Freedom Fiends Distance Learning Anarchy Series with Freedom Fiends Michael W. Dean.
Broadcasting from my windowless bunker.
And Neema Vedadi.
Go, go, Freedom Fiends!
Ready to cat, Neema?
Scrutinize these.
You got lots of effects on there. If we're going to cat.
Just one. Just one.
Stop
just
it.
One. This is the central scrutinizer's little brother. Little brother. Little brother is watching you.
Yeah. We have toys. So, what's toys. Up, Neema? Neema.
Chilling.
What's up,
yeah.
Man? Yo.
Yeah.
Yo.
So, sorry about that.
About what?
Pushing buttons. I couldn't help it. It flashes at me. It's a DJ mixer, so there's a little BPM button that you tap, you know, so the mixer knows what the BPM is.
I know. You asked me what was the BPM flashes. Of our talking, and I'm like, why?
Yes.
What?
I was gonna tap it out.
It depends how much coffee we've had, I think.
Beat sync our voice, our vocal effects.
Yeah. Yes. I'm installing Linux Mint Debian on this new old computer I got. So there may be some background noise because this is kind of noisy fan computer a couple feet away from me. But, you know, I started doing it and just, you know, hey, it's a learning hospital here at the Freedom Fiends.
Yeah, yeah. I tried to download Puppy Linux yesterday with you.
Yeah.
I guess I didn't try. I successfully did it. But yeah. when you were like, okay, let's do something else. I'm like, okay, let me just shut down my Puppy Linux.
Yeah.
And the puppy wouldn't go away. It was like biting me at the ankles the whole time. It kept being like, this is your first shutdown. Do you want this setting or this setting? Literally like 14 times.
Yeah.
I was like, ugh, well, bad puppy.
The thing about puppy is it's really small and not as hardy as other distributions of Linux, and
it is a puppy.
Actually, they're different distributions of puppy, and they're called puplets. And puppy is basically the idea is to install it to a USB drive and carry it with you, and that's your computer. Like you encrypt it, you have the operating system on there, and you have your documents on there, and you can go to any computer, change the boot sequence, go into this whole operating system, do everything you want to do, check your encrypted email, you know, do stuff on the internet, do, you know, you can do like photo manipulation, you can do all sorts of things, and then boot back out and set the person's computer back like it was, and there is no record, zero record on that machine that you were ever there.
Yeah, but if it was the first time you were doing it, you couldn't, like, leave quick. You know, if the NSA goons came to get you and you saw them with their ARs, you couldn't, like, quickly yank it. You'd be like, oh, okay, I got to save this setting. I got to save that.
No, I think you can set it up to do that if you're running from a USB drive.
I guess you just yank it out and run away.
Yeah, and Puppy needs more configuration than Mint. I mean, you were like, you know, how do I get the internet to work? How do I get my speakers to work? If you put Linux Mint Debian on your, even running it from a disk, but also if you install it, I mean, like your speakers immediately work. You immediately have access to the internet. It configures things for you. It's pretty cool.
Okay, sweet.
So
because Puppy didn't even have Firefox. It had, what is it, SeaMonkey. And so I was on SeaMonkey trying to download Firefox and I would have figured it out eventually, but you were like, let's do other things.
I know.
So we did other things.
Yep. So, you know, I bought this used computer and before, here's the news you can use for the day. I wiped the hard drive, wiped Windows off it and just, you know, destroyed everything on it, which is good to do with a used computer, especially if you're reinstalling a system because You don't know what was on there. You don't know if it was like it could have been from a police auction and have things on it that could get you in trouble. You don't want to go. You don't want your door kicked in for someone else's problem. You know.
Hell no.
Yeah. So I am.
So clean it up.
I did, and I used this utility called Derek's Boot and Nuke.
Yes.
Which is I think it's Derik. If you search Derek's Boot and Nuke. It's Darik apostrophe S Boot and Nuke, and you download it, make a DVD ISO, put it on your computer, and stick it in the computer, and it brings up this little blue screen window, and you type at the boot prompt, you type auto nuke, all one word, and hit enter, and anywhere from an hour to 8 hours later, it's overwritten triple with DoD level zeros to there's nothing on it, nothing's recoverable.
Nice. Yeah. So, auto nuke, a peaceful nuke that will help you.
Yes. And yes. Now I am,
it's kind of like when you buy on eBay a bunch of old tobacco pipes to smoke out of. You want to soak the tip in some nice alcohol, your favorite spirit, and clean out the inside with the alcohol and get it nice and ready for your new use. So there's no traces
when you buy what?
Old man breath on it.
A pipe?
Pipe.
You buy used pipes, man?
Yeah, man. You can, they're called estate pipes. It's actually a thing, even like pro.
So it's a dead old. Pipe. It's a dead old guy's pipe.
It's a dead old guy's pipe. And yeah, usually there you get really nice pipes that you know an old guy was sitting in his leather chair in his study smoking. But you get it a lot cheaper.
That's creepy, man. Just
clean it out appropriately.
I don't want no dead guy's pipe.
Well, dude, you got a computer, used computer. You think nobody's ever like
stuck it in their mouth and sucked on it all day, every day? No.
Well, typed on it with their grubby hands after looking at porn, things like that. Yeah. You know, when you buy used gear, you're gonna have some grody bodily fluids having been on it.
So. I don't know, man. This one's been cleaned up pretty well, and no dead old men were sucking on this computer, I hope.
Yeah. Well, you can clean things off is what I was trying to say.
So I'm installing Linux Mint Debian on this now. Fresh hard drive, nothing else on it. It's never going to have Windows on it. It's going to be my Linux box, my security box, my experimental box. It's going to be fun.
Yes. Excellent.
You know, my mom, one of the things my mom did for a living when I was younger was she was a certified appraiser, and not just certified, but, you know, had a good reputation. So in LibPair, she would have been one too. Okay. And a lot of what she did was appraised estates for estate sales. So as a kid, I spent a lot of time playing, you know, in the living room and reading books of dead people while my mother walked around the house and put price tags on things.
You didn't go seek out the guns? Like, where's this old man's guns?
No. But, you know, no. I did. The only thing I remember that influenced me was there was this dentist. Like, he had a dental office in his house. Uh-huh. He had the AA book. And I picked up the AA book and looked at it. And I was like,
one day, this will save me.
I did. I had this. Like, I didn't even think I'd ever drink, but I was just like, I'll put this in my memory banks for later that this exists, and then I'm going to read this book on perspective drawing instead.
Okay. But it was noted. You remember that. That's funny.
Yeah.
Yes. I will note this for later.
Yep. And worms. Yeah, and speaking of putting price tags on everything, like what my mother did later was ran a store. There was in a place that was only open in the summers, and we lived 10 miles away in the winter, so she'd bring everything home from the store, all the antiques. So I grew up in a house full of antiques that all had price tags on them, which I think like is kind of why I'm not materialistic. Like, it didn't gross me out. It was just like I knew the price of everything, so nothing impressed me, you know?
Right. Plus, with regard to the estate sale, hey, you can't take all that stuff with you when you die. all that stuff ends up just being stuff that gets resold to people for, you know, a third or, I guess, an eighth of the price.
And then the government takes their chunk.
Yeah, they grab it out of your hand like Ron Swanson grabbed that sandwich from that little girl.
What did he say? The state is a suckling pig that will bite the teat of the taxpayer until the teats are sore and chapped.
Something like that. I just remember him taking the little girl's lunchbox, opening it up, and like eating her sandwich and being like, that's taxes.
I know. You know, they say death, there's nothing inevitable but death and taxes. And it's like, even after you die, there's still taxes.
Yeah. Even after you die. Well, there's actually a great, I watched like four episodes of Black Dynamite the other night just because they were available on Adult Swim. IRSfeedback.com. And there's an episode that was the theme of it, was death and taxes. And the IRS is coming after him. And they treat them like just like another, you know, loan shark agency. Like, they come to him guns blazing, are always trying to kill him. He's like, damn it, IRS. And he pulls out his giant 44 Magnum with the long barrel and blasts back. It's pretty awesome.
You know, I think that thing of there's no, you know, death and taxes, like that phrase, I think that the IRS made that up and taught it in school.
It wouldn't surprise me. Yeah, they'd love for you to think the government was that ingrained into humanity or nature to think it's as natural as death, as a foregone conclusion.
I know, they make it sound like a law of physics, you know?
Exactly, which it's not. It's not. We could get rid of taxes. If the singularity happens, we could get rid of death.
Yeah, so I have a Linux question, so anybody who knows, call in. Oh, wait, this isn't one of our many live shows.
No call-ins today, Michael. I guess you could put it on your Facebook and take a personal call and steal time from the fiends. What's your Linux question? Not that I would know
Charlie,
it.
Charlie, don't step on my computer keyboard. Ugh, thump.
Dude, that's what cats do. That's like their job.
I know.
Yeah. What's your Linux question?
It's about which partition to install it in.
Yeah. Puppy asked me that too.
Yeah.
I called it partition one. I don't know if that makes a difference.
Yeah.
And they're different sizes too. I honestly don't think it would matter, but I mean.
Yeah. Well, I can't get out of this little display here. Anyway, so talk about our new show.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. When I said I stopped screwing with Puppy Linux because we went to do other things. The other thing was talking with a representative of Adam Curry's No Agenda Global Radio. So we hammered it out, and we're going to have a new live show, you know, a third weekly show for the fiends. So all you fiends out there can get excited about that. We'll be on No Agenda Global Radio Thursdays. Right now, we're trying to decide. I guess they're trying to decide on their end if it's going to be from 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. Eastern time.
No, they decided. 30. They decided.
They did?
That's why I made the ads. It's going to be from 3 to 5 p.m. East Coast U.S. time on Thursdays.
Excellent.
And it's going to be a call-in show. It's called The Freedom Fiends Agenda on No Agenda Global Radio.
Yes.
And I know it's kind of a poke.
There's no agenda, but except for The Freedom Fiends
agenda. Right.
Yeah. Which makes it de facto our agenda radio show.
Yep. Yeah. And it's going to be good, man. It's going to be good. It's going to be, there's going to be more fiends.
And, you know,
let them eat fiends.
It's pretty cool to be on a streaming network that's, you know, flagship is Adam Curry.
The Podfather.
The Podfather, yeah.
He co-invented podcasting. He and another guy invented podcasting.
Yes.
Yeah,
cool guy too.
Yeah,
pretty cool guy.
He was on MTV. He was one of the VJs, the video jockeys, when I was. Well, actually, he's born the same year as me, so we were like the same age. But he was the only VJ back in the day that didn't suck when MTV first started. They were all just ridiculous and phony, and he was like, even though he had big hair, he was, you know, you could tell he was kind of real. He was real, and he kind of had a "F you" attitude.
Yeah,
real one, and he's really smart, and he. He's an entrepreneur. He's run some .com startups. It did quite well. And he's just a funny all-around guy. He does a show called No Agenda Radio, him and another guy. And it's very popular and very, very funny and very libertarian.
Yeah. Yeah, I was listening to it. Now, you think he's an anarchist or just a libertarian, minarchist? I didn't get a good sense of it because I only listened to, you know,
the
show.
It's really hard to say. I mean, he pokes fun at everything, and he pokes fun at some things that libertarians hold dear,
right.
Which is part of his poking worldview. But
that's why they call it No Agenda Radio, because he doesn't seem to, you know, push one particular philosophy or another. He just sort of makes fun of things that he thinks are ridiculous from sort of a common sense point of view, from what I heard at least.
Well, I thought it implied that they don't have like a plan, but they kind of do. I mean, he definitely. You know, they definitely pull up lots of sound clips of news of the day and then make fun of the statists. It is planned to some extent.
Okay. Yeah, the formatting. I guess that's kind of different, though. Yeah. The formatting of the show being planned. Yeah, but I mean, I'm totally excited. Are you excited?
Yeah.
It's quick, too. It's like we found out
Tuesday. Like 2 weeks ago, we were like, oh, he's got a show. we're going to get on it. Like, we had contacted them at all. It's just how we roll, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And he was really, and he's being kind of picky. I mean, the other shows he has are like, you know, he's building this streaming network, kind of like LRN, 24/7 streaming thing. And the only shows he has so far are like Jack Blood and...
Well, it's a pretty nice stable now. He's got
Jack Blood,
Scott Horton, and us, and other people who I didn't listen to. But
yeah, he's got like a movie review show that's not political at all, but it's really good. It's some couple reviewing movies and a couple.
Oh,
more.
It's the Married Movie Reviews. Like,
is that
like
what's called?
Married News.
Oh, I don't know. Okay.
Yeah, making fun.
Yep. It's yeah, yeah. What I was saying, not like, oh, he doesn't have many shows. I was like, you know, he's being picky. They're building it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's Scott Horton's home now, and I believe Jack Blood's home too. I believe they both left.
I wonder if that creeps Scott Horton out because we used to be on LRN together.
We're following him. He probably doesn't know.
Look at you. Yeah,
I'm gonna go post on his wall.
Okay.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, we can. The other cool thing is there's like the breaks are up to us. I guess I'll say so. We get the whole chunk of that 2 hours. It's all ours, you know. There's no streaming server cut-ins or anything like that. It's just all of our content, so we can put our own breaks, our own ads, our own music if, you know, got to go to the bathroom, whatever. So we're gonna test that out too and try to just play our ads internally, and that way we won't have to, you know, cut off a caller or stop our thought mid-sentence. We can do it at our own sort of free-form pace.
Yeah.
I think it'll be good.
Which also means like we're gonna have to be more entertaining because we won't have the powerful music coming in and out.
Well, we just get to choose it. Well, I guess we got to test that. We're gonna try to, I guess, play music through my mixer.
Yeah, we're gonna do a test today. And anybody who's listening tomorrow to the show who's a Facebook friend of mine, be on Facebook and give us feedback at the start of the show on volume levels, things like that. That would be really helpful.
There's also a chat room, so I'm wondering if we should start pimping that. You know, there's
I want to wait. I want to wait until we've done a show or two before.
I do too.
So many other things to go to do.
But I think there's potential there. You seem kind of reluctant, but you know, a lot of shows do something like that where they have a chat room. That way, somebody who maybe doesn't feel
get in on the phone
confident
or can't get in
or feel confident about calling in on the phone. You know, some people just don't like to hear their own voice or they're nervous. Some people are more confident communicating, you know, in an instant message kind of format. So I think the chat room would be a good idea, you know, increase our accessibility.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So we got some news, some things to do, some words of wisdom. What do we got today, man?
Let's see. Do you want to start with some news? I guess we don't generally do news.
Well, the name of this episode is The Fiend's 5-Year Plan.
Fiend's 5-Year Plan?
Yeah.
Well, okay. So here's something. In your 5-Year Plan, it might be important to realize what it's like to be attacked by a drone. Because the government has a less than 5-year plan to have drones patrolling our skies.
Aren't they already? Or they just mean everywhere?
Everywhere. Yeah, like the FAA is supposed to... The Federal Aviation Administration is supposed to have changed the infrastructure enough, both bureaucratically and, I guess, you know, regulatorily, however you say that word, by, I think it was 2000... Was it? It was like 2 years. It was either 2014 or 2015. They have to have everything set up, or before then, hopefully. You know, it's like that at the latest by law. They have to have it set up where, you know, we could have thousands of drones all over the country all the time doing various drone activities. Gawker has actually written a pretty good article about what it's like to be hit by a drone strike. And you know, it's weird because you don't really get a lot of that info. You know, you hear the numbers and you think about it and you see the political cartoons. This is some good firsthand type reporting, you know, from somebody who was actually in a drone strike. Although I'm also thinking, you know, there's kind of an opportunity here. Wouldn't it be great to have somebody do a doc on the first responders, you know, the people in Afghanistan who are paramedics who drive to all the various drone strikes all the time and see it and hear their stories. This isn't that. This is a 15-year-old boy, or maybe he was 14. His name's Farheem. And I'm wondering if you'd be cool with me reading a little bit of his sort of experience.
Yeah.
And it's told to a reporter, so it's not exactly firsthand, but we're hearing what Fahim experienced. And he says at about 5 that evening.
Yeah, man, take your time. I'll be setting up Linux. Go ahead.
Yeah, yeah. Michael's going to steal time, but I think it's important to go ahead and give people a little firsthand knowledge of what it's like to have one of Obama's Hellfire missiles fired at you. So at about 5 that evening, they heard the hissing sound of a missile and instinctively bent their heads down. All right, I'm going to just pause that. Think about that. You hear a hiss, you instinctively get down. You know what it is. You know, you don't think, oh, it must be the bugs. Oh, it's this or it's that. It's a car engine. You think instinctively that's a Hellfire missile from a drone. So that's just my interlude. All right, I'll continue. The missile slammed into the center of the room, blowing off the ceiling and roof and shattering all the windows. The immense pressure from the impact cracked the walls of the attached house as well as those of the neighboring houses. Our research team reviewed photographs that Fahim showed us, which he said showed the destruction to the home. Fahim, who stated that he was approximately 10 footsteps away from the center of the Herja, suffered a fractured skull and received shrapnel wounds and burns all over the left side of his body and face. All others in the Herja, at least 7, were injured, but as many as 15 people were killed. Think about that. Just at the place you always are, you hear a hiss, boom, 15 people dead, your skull fractured. That's an interlude. I'm going to continue on. In the moments after the strike, Fahim said he could not think, quote unquote. Quote, I felt my brain stopped working and my heart was on fire, stated Fahim. Quote, my entire body was burning like crazy, end quote. Fahim wanted to splash water on his face, but he could not find any. After a few minutes of confusion, he stumbled out of the gate of his Herja where neighbors found him. They quickly gathered Fahim into a pickup truck and rushed him to a government hospital at Mir Ali, a 10-minute drive away, according to Fahim. Medics there bandaged his wounds and transferred him to another hospital in Banu, the closest major city outside Fatah, where doctors operated to remove shrapnel from his abdomen and repair damage to his leg, arm, and eyes. Following the surgery, Fahim was transferred to a private hospital in Peshawar, where he remained for at least 23 days. In the end, Fahim lost his left eye, which has since been replaced by an artificial one. He also lost his hearing in one ear as a result of the damage to his eardrum. His vision in his right eye is still blurred, requiring ongoing treatment, and he now only has limited mobility. Fahim's cousin, Ejaz Ahmad, who lives just a few kilometers away, did not attend the gathering in Herja that evening and was instead at a friend's home. He discovered the next morning that his paternal uncle, Kush Dilkhan, in whose hardware store Ejaz worked, died in the strike. The bodies were completely destroyed, Ejaz stated. All we could retrieve was upwards of the torso. Wow. So, yeah, there you go. That's another way the Barack Obama administration is destroying jobs, blowing people up in other countries. You know, those people could have done things like Kush Dilkhan and owned hardware stores where people like Ejaz worked. All sorts of different opportunity costs lost here. It's not just, oh, it's collateral damage. Some civilians died. How tragic. It's also immensely, not only just socially, but immensely economically destructive to countries to regularly blow people in those countries up. You know, and you wonder why they can't get it together. Maybe it's because the Barack Obama administration is blowing things up constantly. It's also important to note, you know, in the Gawker article by Hamilton Nolan after this, he ends on this sentence, because this was before the Nobel Peace Prize was awarded to Obama. You know, you can't say, hey, Obama got this peace prize, you know, he hadn't done anything yet. No, he had actually blown people up with drones before it was awarded to him. So the thing ends like this. Later that year, Barack Obama was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. And this is just one drone strike, just one. 15 people incinerated like that after hearing a hiss while they're just going about their daily business. And, you know, you get the normal boilerplate comments from idiots there. And some of them are just so ignorant that I'd like to take a little breakdown here and comment on them. One person comments, well, hey, it's war. War is hell and has always been, et cetera, et cetera. You know, you've heard these comments before. Yeah, war is hell. What are we going to do?
Yeah.
Well, if war is hell, why do you choose to go to hell? I mean, that's a choice. This is a completely and obviously a war of choice, and it was chosen by the oligarchy. So, dude, people who say that, your argument, in addition to being a non sequitur in stories like this, is also stupid. So, fuck you, statist. But yeah, that's what I had to say about drones.
Cool. I'm listening to the Freedom Fiends on Linux.
I don't think so.
Are you? Are you excited about that?
Yeah. I'm going to close everything down now, though, and work on this later, because I'd have to steal so much time from the Fiends to do this that I wouldn't be able to say anything in the whole hour. So let's go sell some things.
Yeah.
And come right back.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Michael Dean from the Freedom Fiends, and like you, I'm concerned with privacy on the internet. The electronic police state is strangling our previous protections, and the central scrutinizer is trying to squint into all areas of our lives. That's why smart people surf the net with a VPN or virtual private network. I use a VPN from Bola VPN. Bola VPN has your utmost security in mind and will allow you to surf, email, and do other computing tasks without leaving a trail of breadcrumbs across the internet. Unlike many other VPN providers, Bola VPN doesn't log traffic. With Bola VPN, you can change your apparent location or disappear completely. Bola VPN has been around since 2007, which is OG in the VPN world. Bola VPN is easy to install and configure. Best of all, it can be had for less than 25 cents a day, which is a small price to pay for this much security. And if you open a support ticket saying you heard about them through the Freedom Fiends, they'll add 3 extra days free. That's Bola VPN at BOLEHVPN.net.
Ugh, I'm so sick of looking at Steve's wedding pics, and I'm all out of passive-aggressive comments. What else am I supposed to do at work all day?
Sick of stalking your ex on Facebook?
Yeah!
Are you all out of cute cats and autocorrect mishaps to lolat?
Duh!
Freedom Fiends to the rescue! The Fiends now have a blog. Read all about the latest tyranny today. Dream about lip pair. Laugh while Western civilization collapses. Just click on the cat icon to the right of freedomfiends.com. Freedom Fiends blog. Read it!
Rolling. Someone just said it's wormtacular that we have a new show.
Yeah, it's completely wormtacular. Knives, man.
If we're doing
knives.
three shows a week, am I going to just constantly have postpartum depression?
You'd think you'd have less, wouldn't you? Because you're going to be podding more, podcatting more. So
it'll just save up, and in 4 years, I'll just have a breakdown and go, I must sleep.
That'll be fun.
Postpartum depression. Jerry Maguire. It's not really depression, but yeah, Jerry Maguire. Yeah. Who's going with me? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And then I'll go with you.
Yeah.
We'll go start another podcast.
I know. Well, you know when a band is like, well, they say, you know, when a band is starting to wane, when they start doing solo shows. And I actually started a solo podcast, but then invited you to help with it.
Yeah.
Which bands often do. Because they don't know any other good musicians that they can work with, so they take
Darby Crash.
His band sucked. His solo band sucked. But you know what they generally do is like, you know, there's four guys in a band. One of them goes to makes a solo record, takes two of the guys with him to back him up on it. Basically, it's just a record of his band without the one guy in the band he doesn't like.
Nice.
So Darby Crash, you know, I was thinking, I wonder if Kurt Cobain killing himself had anything to do with, was inspired in any way by Darby Crash, because Kurt was a huge fan of the Germs. He said that many times, and, you know, he was such a fan that he got their guitar player to be in Nirvana.
Yeah, I mean, you know, when I was thinking about it, I was thinking about poor Pat. He had to go through that twice, and you were like, hey, reverse engineer that, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, Kurt Cobain wanted to be in ways like Darby, you know. He hired his guitarist, and I was like, yeah, and he took that self-destruction and destruction of the set thing to a whole new level, at least, I mean, as far as where he would destroy stage, like national live audiences, like on SNL, just breaking shit.
Well, I think from the bit I know about Kurt Cobain, and I didn't know him, I never met him, you know, I met Chris, the bass player, sort of knew Dave before he joined Nirvana back in D.C., knew the drummer in the Melvins that was in that band. I remember talking to Dale from the Melvins right after Kurt died, and I was like, you know, I was thinking, like, there have been times when I was kicking heroin where I wanted to die, too. Maybe that was it, or he couldn't, you know, couldn't be happy without it and couldn't be happy with it. And he's like, yeah, I think you're right, Michael. And that guy knew him and was in a band with him. But I think what Kurt wanted from what I know about him was to have, I think Kurt wanted a legacy more like Pat Smear's legacy. I mean, like Darby Crash's legacy. You know,
Better to burn out than fade away.
Yeah. I think Kurt wanted to, you know, make one incredible record, blow people's minds, die, and then have it be this like secret, like, oh, you have the button. Oh, you know that band. Oh, you have the burn on your wrist. You know, oh, you know, like I think he felt bad and guilty about selling out or about being popular. I don't even know if they, I don't think they sold out at all.
But, do you think Kurt had a circle?
Maybe. I don't know. I wonder if he had
a good question.
A germ circle burn germ on his arm.
Yeah. Probably. A cigarette maybe. Burn on his wrist.
Maybe. This is all conjecture. Who knows? But, you know, I was talking about the movie The Decline of Western Civilization.
Yeah.
That punk documentary by Penelope Spheeris. What I didn't bring up was that the title and mood of that movie is the inspiration for the tagline of the Freedom Fiends blog, laughing while the Western civilization collapses.
I was wondering that. I was wondering if that was a happy coincidence or if there was some kind of inspiration, but it was inspired.
It was. I know now. I didn't realize it when I did it. It was just something, you know, you have to enter all these things when you start a blog, and I was like, well, I'll put that and think of another one later if I can. But everyone likes it, so we're keeping it.
Yeah, yeah, I like it. And we put it in our ad copy for the blog ad, so we got to keep it now. for the immediate future. Yeah, and the blog's doing well. A lot of people visiting it. It's up in our Alexa ranking, and so I think the blog is a good idea. And I'm really thankful to our guest bloggers
for
they're giving us some real quality
great stuff,
content.
Man. Yeah, great stuff.
It really is. It's wonderful to open the thing up like that too, you know, and not just be the only ones being fiends. It's wonderful to have other people, on the same page,
fiend
talking fiend speak.
Yeah, they're fiend with fiends. They're fiend with a small F. We're fiend with a big F. Yep.
Yeah, yeah. And that's just for historical analysis. It's not like we're better than them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, we're doing really good with a lot of statistics and figures. We had our biggest month ever. The month's not over, and this cast isn't out yet, and tomorrow's cast isn't out yet. We've had 4.7 terabytes of downloads, which is definitely the most we've ever had.
Moving up in the world.
And I've lost 15 pounds exactly on the Fiends diet.
Yeah, still losing weight, huh?
Yeah.
So 5 more to go before you start talking about it.
Maybe. I don't know. I think 30.
As if you haven't been talking about it.
I think 30, writing up the blog post. I think 30. Well, I'll probably do it to 20, but it's going to be a long post. It's going to have
so what did you eat for breakfast this morning?
A banana and 2 small glasses of like V8 mixed fruit juice.
Okay. Okay. But you don't consider a banana too sugary for you?
No.
Okay.
No.
Because it's not
a paleo diet, man.
Yeah,
it's really not. It excludes large amounts of a lot of things that are forbidden in paleo. Like, I don't eat tons of potatoes. I don't eat tons of peanut butter. I don't eat bread at all. I don't eat refined sugar.
Worms.
Don't drink milk. I wonder if cavemen had milk. I mean, occasionally, do you think, like, you know, they shot an emu with an arrow? And when they went, it was dying and like squirting milk, and they tasted it. Do you think cavemen ever tasted milk? Well,
maybe.
Human milk.
Yeah, human milk, obviously. I don't know. I mean, would you want to drink? I mean,
milk out of something that was dying.
I would think the dying animal's milk wouldn't be something you would want to put in your
probably
mouth.
Probably not, because when animals are dying, if it doesn't happen quickly, they get adrenaline in their blood.
Right. It makes the meat taste bad, so I would assume it might make the milk taste bad. I don't know. I don't know how milk works. You know, I'm not a biologist.
Yeah. I mean, if you shoot an animal and it's not a clean kill and it runs for a quarter mile, it'll keep you from dying to eat the meat, but it's going to taste really bad and probably make you nervous.
Yeah, yeah. Although, maybe I wonder if maybe I'm just being racist. I don't know. But maybe I wonder if some cultures, Bedouin cultures or nomadic cultures, maybe they would drink the milk of their own, the animals that carried them, camel milk, horse milk. I mean, they're mammals, right?
How's that racist?
I guess it's not racist.
I mean, first of all, what race were cavemen? We don't even know. Second of all, you know,
I guess in my head I was imagining a Bedouin drinking camel milk, and for some reason, because I'm so used to people calling me a camel jockey, I thought that's racist, but it's not racist. That's not racist.
There weren't Bedouins in the caveman days, and there may have been camels.
Well, what do you mean caveman days? I mean, there was likely nomadic cultures in the sort of style of Bedouins.
They weren't Bedouins. They weren't what's called and considered a Bedouin.
Okay. Proto-Bedouins.
Yeah. I think they're Hottentots.
No. Hunter-gatherers. Hunter-gatherers.
Hunt-and-tots.
Yeah. I mean, the caveman, like the stereotype, that doesn't really exist, did it? I mean, Ugg with a furry loincloth in an actual cave, you know, dragging his wife home by her legs.
Well, let's see. Let's take those part by part. Probably loincloths, because those have been found. You know, probably some kind of fur clothing, crudely made, or just, you know, not sewn, but just worn over the shoulders. Let's see, dragging the wife by the hair. I don't think so. Who knows? What else did you say? Ugg. Yeah. Early proto language. What else did you say?
I think it was just those three things.
Speaking of Ugg and proto language, there's a movie I want to recommend. It's a Planet of the Apes movie. It's Rise of the Planet of the Apes, which is... I did not see the new Planet of the Apes movie from 2001 that has, like... what's her name? The girl from Fight Club in it, and Marky Mark.
Helena Bonham Carter and Marky Mark.
Yeah, I didn't see that. But this came out 10 years later, 2011. Much better special effects from what I've seen of, you know, trailers of the other one. And it's the prequel to the 2001 one. The 2001 movie is, you know, the apes are in power. They have evolved, you know, they have advanced science and powers, mm-hmm. and the humans are slaves. This movie takes place in current time, and it's the monkeys escaping from the lab and taking over the world that, you know, and some disease that crippled humanity, so the apes were able to. And I have never seen a movie with so many San Francisco police department cops being killed by apes in self-defense, actually. It's pretty awesome. There's a battle royale on the Golden Gate Bridge of like 100 apes versus like 50 cops and animal control officers.
So at least we know the monkeys weren't into kosher or halal because they were slaughtering pigs.
Oh, man. You didn't.
Why'd I have to go there? I did. I'm sorry. Okay. I'm sorry. I apologize for myself.
Yeah. Speaking of people moving to different networks, Adam Kokesh is now on LRN.
Oh, yeah. You were telling me. I was listening to somebody and thinking, wow, he's great.
Yeah, and I wrote Ian, and I was like, who is he? Who is this? And he's like, it's your buddy Adam Kokesh. And I was like, wow, he's really great when he's not talking about other people's sex lives.
Yeah, yeah.
Sometimes. The ladies in Keene took him to task for talking about other people's sex lives. He made a movie.
What was he saying? Oh, he was saying
he made a movie that said that liberty ladies should have lots of babies. And they were not happy with that.
I mean, it's not that bad of a sentiment. I guess it depends on what he actually said. I mean,
yeah, I didn't hear
it.
Can't judge
a book by its cover and stuff.
I mean, you know, two ways I could take that. One would be, you know, the future of the liberty movement is children, which, you know, is the Stephon Molyneux
thing. Kind of the Stephon Molyneux thing, yeah.
But it also kind of sounds like, you know, it reminds me of like, breed our race, woman, breed our people, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Like it's your duty to the party.
I don't know what he said, but they were upset about it.
Huh. Well, maybe we can watch it and give him some constructive criticism. I know you're fond of doing that.
I have another movie suggestion. Did you see Last Days Here yet?
No.
It's on Netflix, Last Days Here. It's a documentary, mind-blowing documentary. It's kind of like Intervention meets Spinal Tap. And I actually thought it was a scripted drama for the first 5 minutes until I realized it was a documentary. It's a awesome train wreck of a life story with some redemption in the third act and lots of surprises.
Are these the Norwegian death metal folks that remind you of...
No, this is an American metal dude from the 70s, the singer in a band called Pentagram, which is about the most metal band name you could ever have. And they were very influential. They were kind of like a tough street version of Black Sabbath in the 70s, like when not a lot of bands were doing that. And they almost got signed like a bunch of times. Like the guys from Kiss came to their basement to see him play and left. And you know, the producer,
I wouldn't let Kiss in my basement in the first place.
You know, the producer from Blue Oyster Cult came and checked him out at a club and was like, and left, you know, mostly because the singer, while he was really good and really charismatic and a good songwriter and a good frontman, he was his own worst enemy. Drug problems, alcohol problems, you know, insult, you know, like we joked recently about, like, yeah, that'd be like if, you know, Led Zeppelin came over to your house and you kicked him in the nuts when they came to see your band. He was kind of like that. You know, he would just say absurd things to people that were trying to help him. But now he's like, in this documentary from a few years ago, he's like 55, looks about 75, crack addict, heroin addict, living at his parents' house and trying to get the band back together.
Still?
Mm-hmm. Mm. He does by the end of the movie. And he meets a hot chick who's about half his age and marries her and has a kid. Oh, wait.
They any that, good?
Yeah. For what they are, they're really good. And they're really popular. I mean, they have a cult following. I mean, they played in D.C. and like 2,000 people showed up.
What's their name?
Pentagram.
Pentagram. That's
but
right.
It wasn't original awesome. Members. It was him and, you know, a bunch of ringers. But they interviewed some of the original members, too. And they're like, you know, so are you going to be in the reunion? And like, no. And he's like, but I do have one bit of advice for anybody that's going to see him. He's great. Go see him. Buy a ticket. But don't buy it in advance. Walk up to the door and buy it at the door because you don't know if he's going to show or not. Because he's done things like...
Words of the wise.
He's done things like... You know, had a club with 2,000 people recently, like in the past few years, you know, packed audience, paid, you know, $20 each to see him, walks out on stage and ODs on heroin and falls on his face and has to be taken to the hospital.
Yeah. That's lame, man. It's not, I don't know. I feel like it's really not cool to OD for your show.
It's
I know
really
it's like
not.
Kind of like metal, like in that scene, you know, where Darby Crash is so fucked up and he's playing the song and like cutting himself and then just collapses.
Yeah.
I guess that's kind of cool to watch in retrospect.
Better, it makes a good documentary or a,
yeah,
good,
it makes
you know,
a good
biopic.
Documentary.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But man, I'd be pissed. I remember I went to see Slim Thug once and the Boss Hog Outlaws, and they were like an hour late to their show, and they played like a 20-minute set, and they were really awesome, but it made me like them a lot less.
Yeah, you know, I can.
That's
I don't
not
like
cool to do.
I don't like when bands are late, but I can understand when they're late. But once they're late, why do they cut their set short? You know,
yeah,
you're there,
exactly.
Man. Play an hour.
Yeah, exactly. That's what we paid for, man. We come here to see all these local people. I mean, not that they were bad, but
yeah.
Came here to see Slim Thug.
You know, the couple
came
times
to ride on foes.
The couple times I passed out on stage, I'd usually wait till near the end of the set because I'd be drinking before and then drink a lot during the set. So, you know, people got their money worth and they got the finale of like in the second to last song, I would, you know, fall off the stage playing my bass face first and be unconscious with two black eyes.
Okay, so yeah, maybe that's the way to do it. Maybe it's a timing thing. Shoot your heroin, you know, a little bit before your encore so you can go out with a bang.
Yeah, as David Lee Roth said, craft your buzz.
Craft your buzz, yeah.
Yeah.
There was a quote on Facebook the other day. It was write drunk, edit sober.
Ah,
sort of the same vein. I think it was Hemingway or something.
That's
it
brilliant.
Was
I was
to
just going
to
say, that sounds like Hemingway. So this movie, Last Days Here, my final summation of it is, picture Darby Crash from The Germs if he'd been a metalhead instead of a punk, hadn't OD'd, and was living with his parents 40 years later.
Yeah, maybe it was better to die.
I know. Better to burn out than to fade away.
Is that a Neil Young song?
No. Oops, wrong effect.
Is that a real song?
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is the story of Johnny Rotten. The king is gone, but he's not forgotten. Which is kind of funny because actually Johnny Rotten didn't burn out. He faded away. He came back and had his band Public Image Limited, who were great for a while. And then he got really fat. And then the Sex Pistols reunioned. And they were all the notes were in the right place. I saw that tour and walked out halfway through it to go bang a chick that I met. And you know, like my idols were playing and it was so uninspiring. I left halfway through to go screw someone I could have. Who would have screwed me after the show, you know?
After the show. I was going to say, you know, you got to take your opportunities when you got them, but...
Well, no, because she would have, it was on the
hook. But yeah, if you could have waited.
Yeah.
Okay. She was still seduced from before. She would have still been seduced from before.
Yeah. She was a paralegal, which, maybe that's why I like paralegals. No, I don't know. Huh? I'm married to a paralegal.
Yeah, yeah. Who sings It's Better to Burn Out Than Fade Away?
Neil Young.
Neil Young? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, because... when I was really young, I liked to get Nirvana bootlegs, like after they died, and there was one called Better to Burn Out than to Fade Away, and there was also one called The Needle and the Damage Done. Are those from the same song, or are those two different Neil Youngs?
Two different Neil Youngs. Well,
they're both Neil Young.
But okay. Nirvana covered them?
No, they were just the titles of like compilations of a bunch of bootlegs and live stuff and B-sides.
Okay. Of who?
Nirvana.
Okay. So but
they were titled that way, Kurt, because I think those titles seem apt to
Kurt didn't Kurt name Cobain's these. Story. Kurt didn't name these, and they were after he died.
I think so. Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Because I was going to say, if he covered "It's Better to Burn Out Than to Fade Away," I would say that was admitting his 5-year plan.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
yeah.
You know where the term 5-year plan comes from, right? It was the communists.
I thought it was like Stalin.
The USSR had 5-year plans for socializing the country, for communizing the country.
Right. Yeah. Right. And. They would lie about their progress throughout the whole thing, and they didn't have a pricing system, and they never actually did anything. And even if they did meet the plans, it's not necessarily what people needed. I mean, who knows what the market needs 5 years from now? Nobody. It's an impossibility to know exactly that and in the exact quantities and the exact prices. So 5-year plans are not good ideas.
Yeah, and I liked it. It was like I read some summaries of it, and it was, you know, they divided it up into different things and, like, you know, food – this, that, transportation, whatever. And when one of them was consumer goods, and under consumer goods, it listed like chairs, bowls, and shirts, or like that was the only consumer goods listed. I'm thinking, like, you know, I'm not saying I wanted an iPod, but, you know, maybe something other than shirts, bowls, and chairs.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you remember in 1984, and it's fiction, but that's what a lot of the stuff is based on when they're talking about, you know, I can't get my razor blades. Do you have any razor blades? And Winston's like, well, we haven't had a new shipment of razor blades in a year. All sorts of little things that are basic that they just don't have. And Jeffrey Tucker also in his, what's the name of his book? A Jetson's World. There's one chapter where he talks about a friend he knew from the former Soviet Union who bought everything he could find. Like when he first came to the country, he would just like buy like 5 VCRs just to have them because it was a habit.
He was cashing them.
Yeah, exactly. It was a habit he picked up living in the Soviet Union, where everything, consumer goods, anything that you would want in your household was just so scarce. If you came across a group of them, you would grab them and trade them or keep them for later consumption. And he said this friend of his just had an apartment full of things. Even when he was in America, it was just a habit that was ingrained into him. If you see something, you pick it up because you never know.
Yeah. We're going to take a break here, but yeah. I mean, a break, not a break. We're going to go sell things. Yes, we're going to sell things.
You've read books, attended lectures, and you know the Constitution well enough to know it's a well-crafted blueprint to create an ever-increasing federal empire. But there's still one thing missing.
Buttons!
Freedom Fiends now has buttons. We have Freedom Fiends, Anarchy Gumbo, and 2 designs for Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. Wear them with pride. Use them to start conversations with statists. It's only $6 for 4 buttons, including shipping. Go to freedomfiends.com and click on the link at the top that says buttons.
Have you swallowed too much of the state's poison? The Freedom Fiends will stick their fingers down your throat and hold your hair back while you hurl. Check out the new show, The Freedom Fiends Agenda, on Adam Curry's No Agenda Global Radio, streaming live every Thursday from 3 to 5 p.m. East Coast U.S. time. The Freedom Fiends Agenda is Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi's fun and feisty chat about market anarchy, self-defense, real money, the digital police state, activism, DIY media, sex pets, and rock and roll. Call in soon before they get droned. Live studio number 307-215-5171 or via Skype to username kittyfeet1. Listen live at nagradio.com. That's nagradio.com. The Freedom Fiends from freedomfiends.com.
Yo, Neema.
Roland.
What's up?
So, Wampanoag Gangnam style.
Who's this Daniel Coxon fellow that contacted me on Facebook?
Dan! Dan's the man. Dan was my good friend freshman year of college at University of Texas. He did not come back after that, though. But he was my get into a bunch of trouble, go out drinking, party, go to Mexico, have the police search your car, all that kind of good stuff. He was, Dan, my friend. He also was a libertarian, and his dad, I think, writes for Doug Casey.
And his dad was an editor for some
the Casey Report.
Yeah, some heavy hitters. I forget who, but yeah, he
and I went out to dinner with his dad and him. His dad was pretty well off. Took us to like the nicest restaurant downtown Austin, and I actually had my first interaction with libertarianism because of Dan. He took me to a campus, like a college libertarians thing, and they showed us a video about, you know, trying to buy something with a silver dollar and why pot should be legal. And I was like, yeah, that's cool, man.
Yeah, he introduced himself to me as Nima's muse and the guy who converted Neema. And then he said, well, that's kind of absurd for me to say. I didn't convert Neema. I just planted the seed. But I had a good chat with him last night. He's a good guy. And he turned me on to a filmmaker friend of his that made a really awesome movie. And I gave him some notes on making it better.
Oh, really? Awesome.
Yeah, which is kind of like...
Is it out yet? Or
no, well, the movie? Kind of. It's this movie that's like... A guy made it as a tribute to his brother who died of a heroin overdose and like only made it for friends and family. You know, it wasn't a movie and like put it up and it's like 90 minutes long. And I looked at a bunch of it and it's like it's stunningly photographed. It's really good filmmaking. And I told him, I think there's a movie in here. You know, it's not just a tribute to play for friends and family. And, you know, I think you could... Yeah. Shorten it down, and there's a real movie in there that a lot of people would be interested in.
Awesome.
Yeah, and first cool. I had to tell him my credentials, you know, like, hey, I've done this, this, and this, because otherwise it's like, hey, I'm nobody, and I'm going to tell you how to improve your brother's, you know, tribute.
Yeah.
No, but it's like, I mean, I think it's something that could get played at film festivals and possibly get distribution.
Right.
It's really awesome. I'm not going to say what it is, because I don't want to send people to the rough cut of it, you know.
Right.
And it sounds like he might do what he's going to do, so...
Yeah, yeah, hopefully. I mean, Dan always knew cool people, and, you know, I guess I had respect for him as a musician, too, because he was a drummer, and he got a show, like, playing backup drummer for some band who had lost their drummer and, like, learned their songs in, like, a week or two and just rocked their little local live gig, and I was like, wow, like... How do you do that? But I guess being a drummer and learning somebody's songs is...
I know drummers that have done that in a day. And I did that as a guitar player, which is harder because there's not just rhythms, there's notes.
There's notes. Yeah, and I was going to say, I guess in retrospect, drumming is probably not as impressive.
Actually,
as
I mean, it's impressive that someone can jump in and do that. And I'm not denigrating him at all, but it's like really pro musicians, I mean, can learn stuff in a day or less than a day and go play. Mm-hmm. Like I've had friends that have been flown out to replace somebody and they're like, you know, they have like a disc man on the plane and they're listening to the record on the plane on the way to go be in the band that day.
Worms.
Yeah. And they just do a long sound check and then do it. I also, the most professional level of musicianship I've ever heard of, I think was when I was playing with Michael Urbano and, Davey Farragher was producing and, David Emmerich-Luck, the guy who coined the word worms, when they were playing with Slish, they were amazing. Actually, the most professional person I've ever done anything with was Robert Downey Jr. When he did in an hour, he did all the narration for the Selby movie. Like, one take Jake, two take, you know, a couple times it was like, I gave him a little direction, but and did another take. But it was the most professional I've ever seen anybody. And he was like, you know, sitting in the lobby, you know, checking his email, you know, doing writing some stuff down, like, and then just like, oh, you're the director? Or he was like, oh, you're the director. Like, I think he expected someone a little more, like, less disheveled than me or something. But,
when I picture directors, I think of them, you know,
look at Tim Burton,
t-shirt.
Man. Tim Burton looks like a homeless guy who has a supermodel on his arm all the time, you know?
Right.
I mean, I look way more together than Tim Burton. Tim Burton in a tuxedo on the red carpet looks like a homeless guy that wandered into the frame, man.
I'm just here for the free food. Yeah. I guess I just brought it up because I wanted to let Dan know if he's listening. Hey, man, you're going to send me your album, man. I want to hear it.
I'll send it. I'll post this on his thing and say, check us out. We talked about you.
Yeah, there you go.
So I got a question. This is, involving the fiends in our internal process to see how it works. Do you think that we should move the Wednesday show to Tuesday or Monday?
Yes, yes.
You do? Did you have Tuesday. That same idea?
Yeah, because I don't know about doing a show 2 days in a row. I mean, I guess we have to eventually if we keep growing. But at this point, if we can avoid it, I mean, it's kind of like the urinal situation, right? I mean, you want to have a urinal space between you and the next urinator. So it could be the same thing with shows.
Then there's also
do a show on Sunday, Monday off, do a show on Tuesday, Wednesday off, do a show on Thursday. 2 days off. There you go.
Okay. That's good. So Tuesday is going to be our day from now on.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. I think we still have a promo somewhere that says, every Friday, the Freedom Fiends will have a new and exciting...
Oh, yeah, huh. Well...
We grow, man. We grow.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Speaking of growing, I'm going to put some music in at the end of this. These two songs that I did with DJ. Her singing. Did you hear them?
I did, yeah. Pretty dope.
Yeah.
Pretty funny.
Yeah, it's... one is called Dick and the Debbies, and one is called I Love My Little Bitches. And they're both by our virtual band called Mother and the Fuckers.
Right.
Which
right.
I think is one of the cool, like somebody should have used that name. Some they band should have
well,
used
you,
that.
Well, you did. You
yeah.
Did.
Yeah. So these are actually songs that we wrote for the audiobook of something we wrote called The Plump Buffet, which is it's a cult. It's a sex cult run by a bunch of cats.
Oh. Right. And, you were talking about that the other day. Yeah,
Dick and the Debbies. Is DJ singing and me singing back up and London May from Sam Hain playing drums on both of them, I think. Yeah, actually both of them. And I played guitar and bass, and it's Dick and the Debbies is like praising Dick, the leader of the cult, and the Debbies are what he calls all his cats. They're all Debbie.
Ah, okay.
And then I Love My Little Bitches is a darker, slower kind of moody song. Kind of sounds like Susie and the Banshees at the beginning and Nirvana by the end. And it's sung by Mother of Mother and the Fuckers, and it's her. She's a dame, a female dominant, and she's singing down to her little bitches who are in the audience and whipping them, and they're mice, actually. She's a cat. And she's actually inspired by this woman named Texas Terry. Do you know Texas Terry?
Mm-mm, no.
She was a singer in L.A. Who had a band. It was kind of like Iggy and the Stooges, fronted by like a really hot, from a distance, middle-aged woman. And they were raging, and they were really popular. And I knew Terry. I know Terry, and I like her. And she was just the perfect template in my mind when I was writing this story with DJ Dick and the Debbie, or The Plump Buffet.
Nice, nice.
Which is available. Well,
when you said Dick and the Debbies, I almost thought it was a verb at first. Like, oh, I am dicking
the Debbies.
I'm dicking the Debbies.
I didn't think about that double entendre, but it works. You can actually... download the whole Plump Buffet audiobook on patiobooks.com for free. And it's the most ambitious spoken word media I've ever done. It's like an hour and a half or 2 hours long. Might be a little longer. It's in like 10 sections. Might be 5 hours. I don't remember. But it's it's in like 10 or 15 chapters. It basically, we got a bunch of voice actors and did it like a radio play with sound effects.
Nice.
And a narrator, and it was really
who was
really
the narrator
fun. My friend George Earth.
Okay did he help out with the Guns and Weed movie?
Oh, he did the little animation of,
I was gonna say,
what's
yeah.
a presidential election? Well, son, yeah. That's when the robots feel really good about themselves every 3 years.
Right, that was it. Yeah,
it's just a game. Yeah, like Monopoly or Waterboard. George is great.
Yeah.
I've known George forever, man, from San Francisco and LA.
Is his actual last name Earth, or is that like a hippie thing?
No, man. He's not a hippie. It's George Earth. He's kind of hippie, but he's kind of he defies everything. He's Greek. His mom's from Greece.
Ah.
Yeah. He's great. I love him. He's wonderful. Yeah. So I got a couple announcements here. One is the No Agenda globalist radio, global radio, their calendar on their website. They're still working out the website. We probably won't even list it on there for a while. They haven't updated everything yet, but they're very busy little elves. They have a like embedded Google calendar on there of their shows.
Ah, okay.
If you are not signed into Gmail or if you don't have a Gmail account, when you view it, it's in London time. But if you view it when you're in your local time, it'll give you the correct local time for all the shows. I actually was viewing it the first time with a VPN from London, even though I was logged in. And I was like, why is this in London time? But I did about 2 hours of talking yesterday on the phone with two of the tech people that run the place. One of them's named Mr. Gitmo Slave, Sir Gitmo Slave, which is a great name. And he explained it all to me.
Right, right. But yeah. For now, all you need to know is our shows will be on 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. Eastern time.
Yeah. You know, maybe I'm going to put the Dick and the Debbies and the Love My Little Bitches songs, not both at the end. Maybe I'll put one in one of the little commercial spaces in the middle here.
Is there any reason you chose Debbies as the, you know, submissives?
Is it my wife's name is
Debbie.
Deborah.
Is Debbie? Yeah. Is that why?
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, actually, I think it was also inspired by, you ever seen that show, that short-lived animated, really weird show, The Oblongs?
Yeah, I remember the Oblongs. Will Ferrell was the dad. Yeah.
They're
it's a funny show.
Yeah, they live they're like the poor people down the valley, and the rich girls,
the Debbies were the girls Debbies. On the hills.
Yeah, yeah. They're all named Debbie. I think that was the inspiration for it.
yeah. It's actually pretty hilarious because they all look exactly the same and sound exactly the same, and they're all named Debbie. And all the girls from the hill are Debbie.
Yep.
Yeah.
And I actually
met a good little show.
I met the guy who created that show. I've been to his house.
Oh really?
He has a pet pig, like a 300-pound giant pig in his house.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. So does he not eat bacon or does he also eat bacon?
I don't know. I didn't ask him. Some German girl took me over there in L.A. and we spent the day hanging out.
There was an old South Park VHS I had, and in between the two episodes and at the beginning, the creators of South Park had this fake cooking show called Bacon with Macon.
I remember that. And they were feeding bacon to a pig.
Yeah, they had this little baby pig.
Macon bacon with Macon.
Right. And they made a bacon casserole. It was like bacon bits, then a layer of Velveeta, then like a pound of bacon, then another layer of cheese, and then like more bacon on top. And they were like throwing it at the pig. Like, you want some pig bacon or bacon pig?
That actually kind of used to depress me. I don't know if depress is the word, but it seemed mean somehow. I mean,
when they were doing it?
I mean, I don't think
or in general.
When they did it. It didn't seem like animal abuse. You know, I didn't want to like call authorities or anything, but it just kind of was. I was like, that's sad. Like, there's a lot of art that people do, even people whose art I like, who sometimes do stuff that just makes me go, why? Why? I would never do that. Which doesn't mean they shouldn't do it, but yeah, I didn't like that.
Yeah, I guess I really thought it was hilarious at the time, but in retrospect, I could definitely see where you're coming from.
Pigs are also really intelligent. They're more intelligent than horses, and not quite as much as monkeys and apes, and not near humans, but they have a lot of capacity for thought and problem solving. And, you know, I kind of feel like the smarter an animal it is, the closer it is to humans, so the more you have to like respect it or something. But I eat bacon. I just wouldn't feed bacon to a pig. I don't know.
Okay, you just wouldn't make the pig unknowingly commit an act of cannibalism,
right? So I added a new word to the glossary. Well, I added postpartum depression, which we've been saying forever, and I've never put it. It's the mild emotional letdown Michael feels. Michael sometimes experiences the day after recording, editing, releasing, and promoting a particularly tasty podcast episode. But I added another one that I think we should use too. It was a fiend suggestion. Propaganda.
Oh, yeah.
Which is using the tools of propaganda, but for disseminating that which is proper, i.e. the truth.
Yeah, yeah. I really liked that, too, because what was it? We had an episode we wanted to call, you did call, I'm no longer an artist. I use, propaganda.
Yeah, this was a comment on that thread on Facebook.
Right. And propaganda. I like how you took that into account. Because I was thinking, you know, the thing with propaganda is, to me, it has a connotation of the state using it for their own ends. Yeah. And I understood how you wanted to flip that, you know, kind of like the N-word kind of thing and claim the word and say, hey, you know, we're promoting this, you know, we're activists, not just artists. But I like the switch, just you know, adding that little R and changing the A to an E, propaganda, to differentiate it between, you know, something Goebbels would have done.
Or not Nancy Pelosi, well, her, but what's the, who's the czar of everything who's leaving, actually? Ass sunscreen. He's a propagandist. Oh, yeah. He's a propagandist.
He is.
Yeah. To the point of denigrating
statist evil.
To the point of denigrating propaganda.
Yeah. So any update on doing with his life now?
Oh, I think he's going to be he's quitting to get ready to be on the Supreme Court.
I know.
Isn't it funny though? Like, you don't care about government. You think everything's all the same, but the thought of him on the Supreme Court just makes you cringe, doesn't it?
Me too, I guess, man. Yeah, it does. But I guess, yeah, thinking about it, the Supreme Court is already, you know, pretty evil. It's not like they're going to, you know, be any smarter or any better at interpreting the law ever, you know, because it's a systemic problem. It's not just the people you have on the Supreme Court. It's the idea of having a Supreme Court to tell us, you know, what to do.
I know. It's so square, man.
It is. It's square.
Yeah.
So, but yeah. I mean, isn't that a reason liberals nowadays, you know, female liberals want to vote for Obama? They're like, yeah, well, you know, even if he does kill a bunch of people with drone strikes, at least he'll appoint somebody that won't get rid of abortion.
Yeah, that's the problem with single issue activism, is you end up having to swallow the pill of everything else the person does. But liberals are so... They're so brainwashed, man.
They are, but do you think that being a libertarian is a single issue activism or an anarchist? You know,
no,
my single issue.
It's an all
is
issue.
It's kind of both at the same time, though.
It's all
isn't
issue
it?
And no issue. Well, it's single issue in that all freedoms are interrelated and they're all the same thing.
Yeah,
and it's all issues is included in that same thing. You know,
right.
I saw a couple YouTube videos of Henry Rollins the other day. I'm trying to get him. I'm trying to match him up with Stefan Molyneux to do a debate.
Ah, yeah. Yeah, you're poking him.
Yeah, Rollins.
You're like, hey, Stefan Molyneux said your mom's a hoe.
No, I'm not. Although it'd be really good if they did this and we had like a fight style poster where we photoshopped them face to face.
Right,
but,
right.
I want to see a debate with them because Rollins is really bright and Stefan's really bright and Rollins is really statist and Stefan is not. It'd be a good debate. Rollins hasn't written me back yet, but he's on tour right now, so he doesn't always get back that quickly. You know, and I've had dealings with him before. I've interviewed him, and he's in my movie and been to his office and stuff like that and hung out with him. Not hung out, but interviewed him. I'm not saying we're buddies. I know him well enough to write him an email. So I was doing research on him, and I looked up, and there's this one really angry rant from his show when he had a show on, I think it was Independent Film Channel, where he's like, bitching about the government, about the Republicans trying to control the internet. And this was, you know, back when Bush was in, and just screeding about it. And then like kind of tying it into like why we need to fight and for net neutrality. And I'm like, that's how they're going to control it, man. And it's not just the Republicans, it's all politicians.
Yeah. Isn't net neutrality basically government control of who gets internet?
Well, yeah, but it's sold the way they sell it to the kids, and apparently Rollins has bought this line too at some point, which is really surprising to me, is they, you know, they basically say, well, without net neutrality, internet service providers, you know, like so let's say Time Warner is your service provider, they could block Netflix content that's not Time Warner, which is true, right. But in a truly free market, there'd be somebody who would just be like the, you know, we're the unlimited pipe where we don't care what you do, and you know, the way VPNs work. Like VPNs not only don't care what you're looking at, they don't want to know. And they don't keep records. But
yeah, because they make money off of people who don't want anybody to know what they're looking at.
Yeah. And
that's their market incentive.
Another Rollins thing I saw was he was on tour in Seattle and he went out to check out the Occupy Wall Street Seattle thing or Occupy Seattle thing. Like he was just kind of standing on the sidelines of it, observing it.
Yeah.
And somebody came up to him with a video camera and started talking to him and filming it. And I think he was kind of irked, you know, like, I don't think they even asked like, hey, do you mind if I ask you a couple questions on camera? They just walked up and started filming him. And I think that they were libertarian, not leftist, because they were like talking to him about sound money and the Federal Reserve. And then they said like, you know, and this was back when there were, you know, 8 Republicans running, and he's like, you know, who do you think could bring this country around? And he's like, Barack Obama. You know, he's going to do it. He just needs time. And then he's like, then the guy, the libertarian, the camera guy's like, do you think any of the Republicans would be good? And he's like, no. He's like, what about Ron Paul? And he said, no. And he'll never be president of America. And he said, are you sure? And he said, I'd bet my dick on it. Which is going to be my new term. I'll bet my dick. That's I'll great. I've never heard it, and it's funny. And his reason, you know, why don't you think Ron Paul could ever be president? And he says, because I still have faith that there are enough intelligent Americans out there that would never happen.
Man, what's wrong with that guy? Man,
I know. He's so smart, and he's so, like, logical with so many other things, you know? I just don't get people defending the state.
Well, maybe it's like that when you were talking to Eric S. Raymond, and you were like, you know, how come a lot of these smart scientist-type people think that, you know, the government should be involved? I mean, is it like a moral thing that they just think that they're so smart that they should run the thing? And Eric was like, no, it's not at all, you know, anything like that stemming from morality. It's just they think, they make the mistake of thinking that society can respond to inputs the same way, you know, technology would, like a computer or a man-made device would. They don't understand how complex society is. So they think that the same methods they use in their work life, you know, with regard to experiments in science and computers, they think that society and humankind will respond exactly the way that those controlled, planned, simple systems will.
Yep. And on that note, let's sell some things and then come back and talk more about the free market and people who ignore it.
Mm-hmm.
Want to contribute to liberty but short on cash? You can help the Freedom Fiends without even spending a post-1964 dime. Download uTorrent and start seeding Fiends episodes. Follow twitter.com/fiendtorrents to grab the past episodes and new ones as they post. Leave your computer on, seeding the torrents, while you're at work or asleep. The more people seeding the fiends, the more drone-proof we'll be when the boot comes down. That's twitter.com/fiendtorrents.
Gun Training with the Non-Aggression Principle, Volume 1. Basic Handgun and Rifle with Jared Waltz.
First rule of being alive is you own yourself.
A groundbreaking approach to firearms and self-defense training. Beautifully filmed and easy to understand instructions make this one a must-have. Gun Training with the Non-Aggression Principle, Volume 1. New DVD from Michael W. Dean, available on Amazon.
Your house is your property. So, Neema.
Yeah.
Speaking of Eric S. Raymond, I've been also trying to interview Richard Stallman, who is like the second fork or the first fork, however you want to look at it, of the triumvirate of why GNU Linux exists. Richard Stallman actually came up with the term free software, which is different than open source, but doesn't mean free as in money. He says it means free as in beer. And
I thought it's the other way around. He says not free as in beer, but free as in freedom.
Free as in freedom. Sorry, thanks. Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Which sounds pretty libertarian. And, you know, I heard him on Russia Today recently, like, ranting against the government for trying to, like, spy on people. And he's like, I don't have a cell phone because I don't want to be tracked. There's nothing I really am doing that would be worrisome if people found out what I was doing, but I just don't want to be tracked. And he invented the GNU operating system, which Linux was the kernel of. So really, like, when you have a Linux distribution, it's like, I don't know the percentage, but it's something like 90% GNU and like 10% Linux. But the word Linux was just sexier than GNU. GNU is a recursive acronym. It's a mispronunciation of an animal, the new, GNU. And it's, you know, it stands for GNU's not Linux or GNU's not Unix. So it's an awkward bastardization of a term. It's just not as sexy as Linux, and just Linux caught on. Yeah. And Richard Stallman is still spending a lot of his time and effort trying to get people to call it the proper thing, GNU/Linux.
Well, luckily, language is a free market, and I can't think of any way the state will effectively clamp down on it. So, we still do have a good example of the way the free market works in language. And, you know, the market chose Linux. And so that's the end of the story. If he wants to call it GNU all he wants, I think he can. But I don't think he should get upset with the fact that other people aren't adopting it.
Yeah.
What people want to say is Linux.
And I don't know that he's going to governments to try to get it done, although he is a liberal. No. I've been trying to interview him, and I'm like, you know, I said, well, it's an market anarchist capitalist, which is the term I'm using now. I like it. Market anarchist.
Market anarchist, yeah.
And he said,
I like that better, too. Market anarchist.
Let's start using that. And he said, we use it in our promo, actually, for the new show on the Adam Curry Network.
Adam the Curry.
Yeah, so I asked, you know, Stallman and I went back and forth like 8 or 9 emails. I'm still waiting for to hear back, but I don't think it's going to happen. I mean, he had all these hoops he wanted me to jump through. He's like, you must read this list of terms, you know, like, don't use the word content. Content implies intellectual property. And I'm like, ugh. I mean, at this point, it'd be easier to get an interview with Michael Jackson, like, now.
Yeah, yeah.
Than this guy.
Well, he reminds me of the comic store guy.
Comic book guy? Yeah,
he kind of
looks like him.
Comic book guy. Yeah, yeah. He's all like, I will do it for you if you answer me these questions three.
Yeah.
And gives you, like, riddles to solve.
I mean, he had, like, 10 demands to be interviewed, and The real deal breaker for me of all of it was, first of all, he said he wouldn't use Skype because it's not free software in his sense, you know, free, like you can do things.
I mean, I guess that's fair enough. I mean, we're not talking on Skype right now because we think it's too status.
Well, we're not talking on it because it's status, but more so because the audio quality is better on Mumble. I use the tools for the job and don't really care that much about the ideology behind them. I do care about like back doors and stuff, but
it's like somebody saying, well, if you're an anarchist, you can't drive to the interview.
Yes.
You must.
And he said that I'd have to call him in Europe. Now, calling Europe, I haven't done it in a long time. The last time I did it, I talked to somebody for about 40 minutes and it cost me like $120. I'm not going to do that for this guy. And I said, you know, a phone network isn't a free software system. You know, to which, I don't know.
Right.
But the real deal breaker was he said, I see you use MP3s. MP3s are a proprietary technology. You're going to have to release this as OGG, OGG format, which is kind of a cool sounding name. It's like OGG, like original gangster, but it's not. It's a
double OG.
It's an MP3 type FLAC related kind of enclosure that works like all the audio on Wikipedia is in that format, and it'll play in a browser, but a lot of people can't play it. And he wanted me to like do that, not just for his episode, but for every episode on every podcast, like at least put out the MP3 and that. And I'm like, no.
Plus, I feel like he makes a mistake that it's almost an economic mistake that liberals always make. I mean, he assumes that MP3 is not this free thing because its intent wasn't free. But I would argue that, you know, the MP3 is probably the most freeing audio format that we've seen thus far.
It is.
I mean, regardless of who invented it, the way it's actually being used by everybody in the world is very free. I mean, you get all of your DRM free stuff is in MP3 format. Plays on anything,
and Apple is paying a royalty when they do that of a cent or something to the Frauenfelder Foundation or whoever came up with the codec. But I would say it's like free, not de jure, but de facto. You know, just because so many people have been like the Frauenfelder Foundation or whatever they're called. Originally, like when MP3 started catching on at first, they started sending out lawyer letters to like content producers and stuff, and everybody just ignored them. You know, it's kind of like prohibition of alcohol. It's like, it's illegal, but everyone's drinking it more than ever, you know?
Well, not even that, because prohibition of alcohol had this giant state apparatus to crack down on it. The MP3 has nothing of the sort. I mean, I make MP3s multiple times a day, every day, and I've never written, you know, given royalty to the Fraunheim organization or whatever they're called.
You know, another influence that Richard Stallman has is his GNU public or general license or whatever it's called. It's kind of like similar to Creative Commons, before Creative Commons, but more specific in a lot of ways. And there's a few different ones like Creative Commons, and it inspired Creative Commons. But Wikipedia, everything on it is licensed with a GNU public license. And if you go click on the license unit on any page. It's going to take you to like a little picture of it's a GNU. Okay. It's like a big yak kind of thing, you know, like a freedom.
That's
yak.
The common thread. I always thought that was a coincidence. I didn't realize it comes from the same philosophy.
Yep. Yeah, a lot of these guys that like I'm interested in interviewing were people who were programmers but also philosophers and like team leaders and you know, like Eric S. Raymond. He was a great programmer, and he was also a great philosopher, but he was never the team leader that Richard Stallman or especially Linus Torvalds were.
Well, I think with technology that is completely paradigm shifting, you do need philosophy to help that fit
drive it
into the human condition. Not necessarily to drive it, but to help us understand how it can best be used. And yeah, I guess to drive its evolution.
Yeah, and I have no interest in interviewing Linus Torvalds, which sounds like Toki's first guitar teacher, doesn't it?
It does.
The inventor of the Linux kernel. Often said to be the inventor of Linux, but not, because Linux is GNU Linux. So,
I mean, enlighten me on this. I always thought the kernel was the most important part of the software.
It is, but it's also like the smallest part. You know, it was like Richard Stallman and his team spent...
Well, the brain is a small part of your body, body percentage-wise, but it's the most important part.
Well, I don't know. I think it's less like the engine of the car and more like the spark plug of the car. You know, it's like Richard Stallman and his team... voluntarily built the whole car, but they didn't have a spark plug, and Linus came along with a spark plug and then got the whole car named after him, and and now Richard Stallman is trying to reverse the free market of language by insisting that people call it GNU Linux. I mean, people don't even call it GNU Linux who are Linux developers. If you go to a Linux, you know, like when I downloaded Mint Debian Linux, you know, the page didn't say GNU Linux up at the top. Like if you scroll down through all the tech stuff of what's in it, it'll say it's a GNU Linux distribution, Debian, blah, blah, blah. But, you know.
Although you and others, you know, even in the Liberty Movement make that kind of mistake. I mean, with calling the thing you put in your gun that holds bullets a magazine only and not calling it a clip and thinking people are ridiculous if they call it a clip. I would say clip probably wins in the free market of words.
Yeah.
More people call it a clip and it's known as that.
I don't mind you calling it a clip as much as I used to. I'd been reading a lot of gun literature back then written by statists and cops, you know, like Massad Ayoub. And it's kind of the same thing of like anybody who corrects you when you call a rifle a gun. I mean, a rifle is a gun, but in the military, you call a rifle, you call a handgun a sidearm, and you call a gun means a giant mounted cannon that takes a crew to run it.
But
so,
I'm not in the military.
Right,
I'm anti-military.
Right.
I would never be in the military.
Right.
So why the hell would I act like I'm in the military and call things what the military calls them?
And I'll still call a rifle a rifle most of the time, but usually that's because, you know, I'm out shooting with somebody and we have eight different weapons with us and some are rifles and some are not. I'll say, hand me that rifle.
I won't. I'll call it the name, what the kind of rifle it is. I'll say, hand me the Mosin, hand me the K, you know, whatever it is.
There you go. Yeah, another place that Richard Stallman, and I don't want to get into a whole thing about him, and I still haven't heard back from him yet, but I think that he hasn't written back.
Because he's not going to.
Yeah, because he was writing me back pretty quick, back and forth, and you know, he said, I'm a liberal, we might disagree on some things, and I said, after
good.
I told him I'm a market anarchist, and I said, hey man, conflict is the essence of drama, and that'll make a better interview, and I love asking statists why they think government guns should be used to enforce the common good. I think that was the deal breaker.
Why you no want freedom? Kind of thing.
Yeah, I don't want to interview Linus Torvalds because he is a socialist. He's really hard to get an interview with because he's, you know, the poster boy. And also, he is a socialist. I mean, I watched this other movie called The Code that someone recommended. It's really good. It's on Google Movies, Google Video, and it's about an hour long. It's in Norwegian, but there's enough English in it that you can understand it. English with Norwegian subtitles. And the narrator is speaking English, but he's a Norwegian boy, like 12-year-old boy or something, I think. It's really strange.
Okay.
But it's got Eric S. Raymond, Richard Stallman, and Linus Torvalds in it. And it's a really good movie. You know, it's the holy trinity of Linux, GNU Linux. But One really funny thing in it is Eric S. Raymond, they have some like banter after some convention, Linux convention somewhere. And Eric S. Raymond and Linus Torvalds are talking. And Linus is like, or Eric is like, so you're going to be at that other thing tomorrow where I'm speaking? And he's like, oh, you can certainly bet on it. And then Linus says, so I hear you and some friends are going out shooting afterwards. And Eric S. Raymond is like, yeah, and I'd really like it if you'd come with us. And Linus Torvalds is like, no, I don't think I'll be doing that.
yeah.
It's also got a really devastatingly wrong view of socialism by some socialist in there that kind of explains the mind of a statist. They show Linus on some talk show talking, you know, they say, so are you a socialist? And he's like, well, and he gives this long convoluted answer that, you know, and he ends with like, well, if you think helping people means I'm socialist, then I guess I'm a socialist. And, but he didn't really say like, you know, government guns or anything like that. Like, but the interview right after it, I don't know who it is. It was some Linux developer in America, Linux developer in America who said like Linux is the single largest redistribution of wealth from the first world to the third world. It's changing things everywhere. And so, yes, it is socialism. And I'm like, socialism. It was a gift. It wasn't forced, man.
Yeah. I think that's the huge difference that statists don't get is they, I don't know if they, you know, disregard charity on purpose.
They see charity the same as charity at the point of a barrel of gun, you know?
Exactly. That's exactly the point I was going to make. You'll see people in comments saying, well, you know, I think we should spend all our tax money
because
on welfare and help
because
the poor.
I'm a generous person.
Yeah, or because, you know, Jesus agreed with me. Jesus said we should help the poor.
He
didn't say you should point guns at people and steal money from them and then give that check to the poor after you take 80 or 90% of it for yourself to buy yourself a nice new car and have your cushy job. Jesus didn't say anything of the sort.
You know, I was kind of surprised that Richard Stallman said, I'm a liberal. I'm not surprised that he is a liberal, but that's such a like boilerplate term for a guy who spends his whole life inventing new concepts and trying to like be very adamant about the importance of certain terms over other terms. You know, I would have more expected him to say like, well, we may have some disagreements. You're a market anarchist and I'm a dialectical Hegelian Marxist with a nod to the medieval guild system as a methodology for organizing society's needs and the common good.
Exactly.
You know, he just said, I'm a liberal. I'm like, really?
I still get upset with that. And I guess I'm being a hypocrite here because of the free market of words and whatnot. But, I mean, liberal and libertarian, I mean, they share the same Latin root, right? Libe or free. And I don't think that liberals are in any sense trying to promote any type of freedom.
But it's free money versus free beer, to quote Richard Stallman. It's, you know,
they want the
liberals
free beer.
Want the free beer. Yeah, they want and the libertarians free beer. Want
I guess,
the freedom.
I guess that is it. I guess that's the difference.
And, you know, that's another place where Richard Stallman really fails with the free market of words. I mean, I can kind of see him hammering away at people of you should call it GNU/Linux or GNU Linux, not just Linux, because that's accurate and credit was kind of taken from him. Although I would just say, okay, whatever. You know, his whole ideology is free software, which is very similar to open source, which is an ideology of do what you want with it, you know. But I guess there's credit included in that too, which he didn't get. So but I think at this point, you know, 15 years later,
he got some credit. I mean, if you're trying to interview him, you know who he is. You know what he did. Other people do as well. I mean, the people who care about that kind of stuff.
Yeah. I mean, the other thing, and he would argue that free software is very different from open source, and he spends a lot of time trying to hammer that away from people into people. But I would say that open source, like Linux won out because it's a cooler word than GNU or GNU Linux. GNU/Linux. Linux is a sexy word. It's got an X in it. It rolls off the tongue.
I would say an X and an L, which is one of the most euphonic letters.
I would say that that battle is also true with his other, that same thing is true with his other battle of, you know, open source describes what the thing is. You don't even have to really know much about computers or have it explained to you to know what open source means.
But free software, he had to explain it to you when he was telling you what it was.
It's not called free software. It's called free software, and I mean free as in freedom, not free as in beer. That's really awkward. That's like,
and clunky.
Which is a problem with me calling myself an anarchist, because it requires an explanation, which is why I'm going to start using market anarchist.
Yep. Although, to the uninitiated, it might sound like you mean you're an anarchist about the market. Like,
I know,
think there should be a market.
But
you don't think you should be that there should be a market. You know, people say I'm a political atheist, meaning they don't believe in Democrats or Republicans.
Yeah, like
saying you're
saying,
a market anarchist to some, they might think, oh, that means he wants to dissolve the market.
Yeah, like using it as an adjective instead of a noun.
Right, right.
Well, I would say that holds true because I consider everything the market. I mean, we're not making any money right now. I would consider what you and I are doing as a free exchange of goods and services. You know, we are enlightening each other.
But liberals don't think that way. Liberals think the market is a bunch of Wall Street fat cats. They think the market is Halliburton and Goldman Sachs. They think that's what the market is, and that's the problem.
Yeah, but the people running the government from behind the scenes, like Ass Sunscreen, they do understand the difference to the point where they want to just not steal your money. They want to start taxing your time. Like with the, you know, they wanted to have the, they had the National Education Association, the teachers union nationally, like mandate.
They understand the difference, but to them that means, well, we need to control the whole market.
Yeah.
That includes every aspect
of
a person's
life. Even like voluntary time at the point of a gun, you know, like a lot of schools, high schools, you can't graduate now unless you go work at a soup kitchen for 2 weeks or something in your spare time. And like, you know, like
Again, charity is not charity if you're forced into it. Not at all.
Worms.
That's just somebody pointing a gun at you and forcing you to do something. It doesn't matter what it is at all. I mean, if somebody mugged you, but instead of asking for your wallet, made you sit in the car with them, go to a soup kitchen and serve homeless people, would you be like, oh, I'm cool with that? I mean, yeah, he threatened to kill me, but I got to help all these homeless people. No. You'd be pissed.
Yeah. And they probably don't threaten to kill you for that, but if you didn't do it, you would not graduate. And, you know, you wouldn't get the piece of paper that you've worked 12 years to get and haven't dropped out of sooner, you know, and you wouldn't be able to be as valuable in society, and you might go to jail. I mean, I could see, like, in Texas.
But even then, there is force. There is a gun there because, you know, taxes are still paying for it. I know it's volunteer group, but to get the government degree that the taxes pay for, you have to go do that thing. There's still force involved.
Yeah. Well, I think it's a good little place to... I will say one more thing about why it was absurd that Richard Stallman demanded that I put up two formats for each podcast. Other than that'd be a crapload more time for me to do that for what's now four episodes a week. When you put two audio files or media files, video files, whatever, in one blog post on an RSS feed for a podcast, it breaks everything. Which, what happens is your podcatcher, iTunes or whatever podcatcher you're using, tries to download both of them, can't play one of the formats and balks, and either, or plays the wrong one and deletes the other, or just will not work and have to be, like, in some cases with an iPod, you'd have to reboot that. And Richard Stallman hates Apple. You know, it's kind of funny when, and I agree, he said Steve Jobs was the guy who made jail cool. Which is really funny because it's like, you know, a computer jail. Like, you have to play in their sandbox. You have to use their software, hardware, store, etc., online store. Right. And a lot of times, like, I've had people take me to task for using Windows and say, you should be using Macs. They're right. They're better. I'm going to start hitting people who say that. Verbally hitting people who say that.
Verbally.
It's like, once you've used Linux a bit... Mac and PC are exactly the same and have the same corporatist problems, and Macs just cost more and have shinier cases and don't do anything more and aren't any better at this point. Linux is really where it's at, and I'm not going to go Linux only. I'm going to still have other computers with other thing with Windows, but the Mac versus PC argument is something that an advertising agency put in your head if you believe it, and the Linux versus the other two, Mac and PC, Linux wins. I mean, Linux is vastly superior in right. every way, and a lot. It's pretty easy to use. I mean, there's kind of. I used to say this too. Repeat this, like, oh well, Linux. You have to be a hacker and a geek and know how to do command line and programming, and it's really buggy and hard and arcane. And like this distribution, I put on, you put it on, and it works. And it's like, okay, there's the browser, there's the email program. It's all it's like Windows, but more friendly. You know?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
like downloading software, you download it from one repository. Not anywhere on the internet, and it's like it's all vetted by people, you know, who mm-hmm. are who know what they're doing. That it'll work, you know.
Right, right. Yeah, it's a whole different thing. It kind of reminds me of that that Ali G show where Ali G is like hanging out with these hippies, and he's trying to hit on this hippie girl, and he's all like, "Hey, baby, you know, I take you to all these nice places like McDonald's," and she's all like, "I don't do McDonald's." And he's like, "Oh, what is it? More Burger King then?" And she's like, "No, none of yeah. it." He doesn't get it.
Yeah. It's like Coke versus Pepsi is Windows, you know, like
yeah, Windows, I don't drink soda, so Windows I'm not going to drink
Windows
Coke or Pepsi.
Yeah, Windows and Mac are like Coke versus Pepsi, and like Linux is, you know, a fine homemade
spring water from the mountains. Water.
Yeah,
yeah, there on you your go. Homestead.
I like that. Yeah. All right, man. I think we're at a good place here to play some Mother and the Effers songs, Dick and the Debbies, and I Love My Little Bitches.
Dick and the Debbies.
Come back tomorrow for the our new show.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. All right.
Peace. Worms. Dick, 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 dick and the Debbies. Yeah! Dick, 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 dick and the Debbies. Yeah! Dick, 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 dick and the Debbies. Yeah! Dick, 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 dick and the Debbies. Yeah! We couldn't remember their names, so now the names are the same. After trial by fire, kept the ones in the side. Now all the killers are tamed. Dick, 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 and the Debbies. Yeah! Dick, 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 and the Debbies. Yeah! Dick, 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 and the Debbies. Yeah! Dick, 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 and the Debbies. Yeah! We couldn't remember their names, so now the names are the same. After trial by fire, kept the ones in the side. Now all the kiddies are tamed.
We'll be right back. Feens Podcast is covered by a Creative Commons Attribution Share Alike 3.0 license. Do what you want with it and spread it around. Tell two friends. Make copies. Email it to everyone you know. Go on the site and comment. This is a conversation. Every week, we'll have an exciting new episode where Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi weave their own unique take on the way the world works and how to find your place in it. Available from freedomfeens.com. That's freedomfeens.com.
Freedom Fiends is proudly syndicated by alterati.com, the Liberty Radio Network, and No Agenda Global Radio.
Subscribe and tell two friends.
And remember, the only power they have is the power you allow them. We're not saying the Freedom Fiends are the one true path to anarchist liberation, but it's a good one. If you want to put your voluntaryist money where your mouth is, consider making a donation to the Freedom Fiends. Go to freedomfiends.com and click on the spinning coin on any post. Then make a one-time gift via PayPal or set up a monthly contribution of as little as $3. Giving to the Freedom Fiends helps advance education of horizontal liberation throughout the world. The Freedom Fiends. We work hard, so send us some money.